Welcome to the forecast. To my right, we have Alex. Alex, how are you doing?
Hello, everyone.
And to my left, we have Garrett. Garrett, how are you doing?
I'm kind of feeling peachy tonight.
Garrett feeling peachy. Ooh, on this last.
Wow.
Wednesday.
You're bringing it back.
Bringing it back for 2018. Giving you a little taste.
On this last Wednesday of February, that's the 28th, 2018. A lot of eights, a lot of twos. What do you think about that, Garrett?
It's all even in here.
We're going to talk about the comics coming out in your local comic book shop or online digitally, whatever you read your comics. Dark Horse Comics coming up first. We got a little mini series starting tomorrow. This is, a spinoff of Black Hammer? I want to say Black Lost Hammer. I was thinking Lost Hammer for some reason. That's not even anything. Dr. Star and the Kingdom Lost Tomorrow is number one. This is Jeff Lemire and Max Fiumari. This dual narrative story set in the world of the Eisner Award-winning Black Hammer series chronicles the legacy of a Golden Age hero, an aged crime fighter desperately wants to reconnect with his estranged son, who he hoped one day would take the mantle of Dr. Star. So it looks like it's going to tell a story from the Golden Age of Black Hammer, like that universe before he got crazy with everybody, and then we'll have a story about his son, too. So it looks like it'll be pretty good. What do you think, Alex? We got another spinoff of Dr. Star. We have Black Hammer number two starting pretty soon also, so they'll run for a little bit at the same time. I think about learning more about the Black Hammer universe. Yeah.
So I didn't know they were going to be, obviously I knew they're in the same world. I didn't realize that they're going to be both going on at the same time. So that's pretty exciting. I'm excited for this. I don't really know a whole lot about it, but any more information I can get from Black Hammer universe is a welcome comic book in my world. So by all means, I'm ready to jump into it.
What I meant by that is that they'll be coming out like in the shops at the same time.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. No, I understand that. I just meant that I didn't realize that Black Hammer 2 was going to be starting up already. I thought it was still going to be like another year.
No, in 2 months. April. Oh, it come out. So they'll be out. This is how many issues does it say here?
I think it's six. Four.
It's four.
Okay, so
I thought it was supposed to be four.
So the last couple will come out when Black Hammer season two, number one and two come out. So that'd be good. Let's see here. DC Comics, Action Comics 998, getting close to that 1,000 mark. I was talking about it before the show. If you look at this variant cover, it's one of the most beautiful variant covers I've seen in my life. Top five, you think, Garrett? Top five covers of last year? Action Comics 998. This is Dan Jurgens. Brad Booth, your favorite, Garrett. Norm Rapmund. This is Booster Shot Part 6. Oh, Jesus, still on this? Garrett, how's it going?
That's weird that it says that, but on the credits, it doesn't even say that's the artist. It says it's Conrad
and Coons
who was doing it. But
that's doing the, he's,
I don't know.
He's credited as a cover artist on this.
The story has been good. Brett Booth didn't do the last issue, which was nice. He's only done one. I know he is going to be on one of these last couple, and you guys ruin it for me, so I can't even enjoy the book anymore when he's on it. But I'm still digging the story. I mean, it's just fun to see what happened if Clark went back to right before Krypton exploded, and when he tries to come back to our timeline, he ends up going into the future. So it's kind of a fun time travel story, and Booster Gold and Skeets are gold, literally. I mean, so good. It's fun to see them back in the universe. They don't really explain where Booster Gold was, but you don't really need to know for this storyline anyways.
What do you think, Alex? I know you haven't really been enjoying this.
Dropped it.
Oh, you did? So you're not even going to get 998?
Yep. I didn't even read the last two issues of Action Comics I had. Oh. I looked through them, and I was like, you know what? I really don't care. So I put them in my box, and you know what? They might go on that burn pile with 52 Superman number one.
Batgirl.
And Ascente's Green Arrow run.
I didn't get that, so it's not on my burn pile.
Batgirl number 20.
I'll give it to you.
Hope Larson and Sammy Basari. Dan Mora on the cover. Dan Mora doing more and more DC covers. Dan Mora's getting on a book soon. Come on, let's go. Quit doing the covers. Alex, I know you've been saying before the show, you're like, this is a book I keep up with month to month. I never miss an issue. How's Batgirl going?
You know, it's really, really good. That's all I really can say. It's a great book. If you love some Batgirl, by all means, get this. Penguin looks like he's going to be hanging out for a little while longer. Judging by this cover, Batgirl's in the snowbank. That's all I know.
And with that movie being on hiatus now because they have no writer-director, this Dylan Becker are going to get for a while, so might as well pick it up if you enjoy Babs and see how she's doing there. Batman.
The new artist on Batgirl, the Sam Basry, it looks like she's going to be on the next couple issues. Issue 19 was such great art. I'm so excited for this like new artist on this book. I'm kind of like, it's a great book itself, but I'm sick of her always having like have son of Penguin. Penguin's in the storyline, so I'm ready for Penguin to kind of like exit stage left. But other than that, great book.
Oh, I didn't know you were getting that book. Batman Beyond number 17. This is Dan Jurgens, Phil Hester, and Andy Parks. This is the Long Payback Part 4. Garrett, how's Batman Beyond been going? Garrett?
It's been amazing. I love... what?
Sorry.
You're cutting out a lot, Garrett, so that's why it was. We can't really hear you. So
what happened?
I don't know. You cut out. We thought we lost you for there for a second.
I know you guys are not going on there.
Batman Beyond.
Back from the future. You know what I mean? But Beyond has been a great. Get this book. Phil Hester, who we're bringing to SuperCon, does the art for it. So good. And right now, dealing with a lot of Batman Beyond's rogues. And it's fun to see them in action, kind of working. I definitely recommend this book.
Detective Comics 975. This is in this 30-page anniversary story, Batwoman faces scrutiny from Batman and Robin. Batman and Red Robin, but stands up for her actions. Will Batman allow her to continue bearing his symbol after everything she has done? This is James Tynion IV. Alvaro Martinez Raul Fernandez. Alex, how's Detective Comics been?
I have a guilty confession here. I am probably 4 issues behind.
Whoa! I know somebody who's caught up because... I know somebody who's caught up, but they're... Garrett, you there? Nope, all right.
I think he's cutting out.
I'm right here. I can hear you.
Literally hear nothing. Me? We can hear you at all. So if we fix that connection, I'll move on and we can go back to Detective Comics here in a second.
Oh, my God. Hello?
I can hear you off and on.
Jesus.
No, it's not his fault.
Hey, now hear me?
No.
What?
Keep talking.
I am talking. Can you hear me now?
Yes. Yeah,
this is fucking the worst.
Now you go. Detective Comics. Tell me about it.
Okay. Detective Comics. Good. About like it not being as exciting anymore. Totally flipped around. I think it's back on the money. Does she deserve to have the Batman mantle on to keep wearing that? And I feel like it's already over for her, so I don't think she has any redemption for what she did. And you guys will find that out when you read the book. But, yeah. It's been great.
And maybe we'll find out what you said when we find where your voice went during that call. Move around more.
I missed most of that.
Move around some more. We'll move on to Doom Patrol JLA Special Number 1. This is Steve Orlando, Gerard Way, Dal Eaglesham. Clayman in the cover. We got a cover that looks like a cereal box. Comic inside, it says. They're all fighting in a bowl of milk. We got who we got on this cover here? We got Lobo. We got Milkman, Wonder Woman. Yeah, a lot of people in here. Batman. Milk Wars finale. As Retcon's foundation shatters, the Young Animal team comes together with the Justice League and even more DC Universe heroes to finish the job. The problem is... Milkman Man and God, I fucking love that so much. Milkman Man and Retcon still stand in their way to right reality. The heroes of Young Animal and DC Universe will have to unlock an outrageous power never before seen in this world. This mind-blowing conclusion will establish new realities for all the DC Young Animal titles. Look for the return of Cave Carson, Shade, and Mother Panic next month. So this actually is acting as like a reboot of the Young Animal line, because they'll all go back to number ones and they're all going to be a little different. Like I say, Shade might be called something else. I haven't really looked at it too much.
It's Shade the Changing Woman.
Yes.
She's a woman of
Panic, Gotham PD.
Yes. So they're all going to be like, this changes the reality a little bit, and it's going to change those books, and so they're going to be relaunching with new number one. So I actually think it's a cool thing.
Question for you.
Yeah.
Wasn't the issue one of this Milk Horse, wasn't it a Doom Patrol JLA special number one
the other
as
way.
Well?
The other way. This is
JLA Doom Patrol.
Yeah, now it's Doom Patrol JLA. Okay.
So. Okay. I saw that and I thought, I'm confused. Why is it called that? But I got you.
Hey, Gary, you sound way better. What do you think about this Doom Patrol?
It's been pretty good. The last couple issues, like the Swamp Thing issue we just read, talked about it on our last episode. It's funny, fun story to follow. You know, me and Alex didn't really enjoy that first special with JLA and New Patrol, so I'm hoping this will be a lot different and a lot better.
It sounds like this is going to be like out there a lot. They're going to unlock a special power that Solar Rageous has never been used before. More DC Universe heroes are going to show up, like people you don't expect. It sounds like he's just going to take everything, like the Silver Age of DC that's kind of weird and out there, and throw it into, pardon the pun, but this cereal bowl, and we're going to eat it up. So we'll see. Flash 441, this is Joshua Williamson and Neil Gouche. Carmine's doing that cover there. Perfect Storm Part 3. The Flash has lost what he prizes most of all. He must call in an old ally to protect Central City while he sits it out back, Wally West. Have you guys caught up in this book?
Yep.
Nope.
Alex, do you mind a spoiler quick?
I don't mind a spoiler. I'm just saying, like, my big thing is I think I've been so deterred by reading The Flash that the last, at least, arc was like, I don't know if I really care about this.
Let me shoot you in the arm here real quick. The last issue, I think it was the last issue, right, Garrett? Barry decided to give up the mantle of The Flash to Wally West. So this is Wally West's book now.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah. He said, you're the real Flash. He said, you're the real Flash. Well, he does say...
He doesn't give up his mantle.
Well, he does say...
Gorilla Grodd steals to Speed Force.
Yeah, but he does say, he goes, hey, you're the Flash the city needs right now. So he's like, you're take over. So Wally West. So it's going to be Wally's book for a little bit. I don't know for how long, but we'll see.
Barry will still be around, though.
Yeah, he'll be around. I would almost like, if you're a fan of the TV show, if Barry's a guy... for a while doesn't have the Flash, the Speed Force, and he stays behind him, he's the guy in the chair. And Wally West takes care of things for a while. Like, Barry's really smart, and like, have him be the guy that's helping out everybody while he's on the sidelines. I think that might be a cool little dynamic there. So we'll see, though. I actually did, like, I...
Have you read this arc at all, Alex?
No. The last thing I read was the, when Godspeed was in prison, was in Iron Heights. That's the last thing I read.
Oh.
That's right before this, right?
So, yeah, I bet if you read this arc, you'd be more stoked because Gorilla Grodd's involved.
I feel like...
I guess,
I was just going to say, I feel like... I think Garrett even mentioned this like a couple months ago, that Williamson was waiting to do this. Like, this is feels like he's been waiting to do this. And maybe there's other things. Like, I'm not sure why. Maybe that because, like, we talked about they wanted to hit that mark with 50. Like, have that war start in 50, so he's like, oh, I got to ramp up to it. But he only had, like, 10 issues to ramp up to, so he had to wait till he got to 40 to do it. I don't know. But anyways, it does feel like this is, like, his story that he wanted to tell from the beginning, and now we're finally there.
Are you caught up on it, Marvin?
Yeah, it's good. Okay. So, Flash, it's good. And I like Neil Gouche. I mean, I've been saying for a while, Neil is a good artist. He should be on this book. And here we go. Here he's on it now. So, called it? Yes. Good guy. Hal Jordan in the Green Lantern Corps number 39. This is Robert Vendetti. Rafael Sandoval. Zod's Will Part 3. Now, I know, Garrett, there's a little show you have called Catch Up with Garrett. I just edited it together. Should be out soon. You actually might be out by the time I listen to this. Actually, you know what? It's ready preloaded, so I can click right now and release it. Zod's Will Part 2, you enjoyed a lot. If I'm recalling correctly, you did like the art a lot. And you said you're looking forward to Ethan Van Sciver's art in Part 3. Looks like he's not on it.
But Sandoval's art is just as great.
I was going to say, I think Sandoval's a little better. I think Ethan is like a little slower. Right. And I think that's why he only does like one, every once in a while he shoots in with an issue. So looking forward to it. I know you enjoyed the second part.
Yeah. I mean, when I think about, I mean, just back on that real quick, when I think of classic Green Lantern art, I think of Van Sciver, but, you know, Sandoval for this book, I think has been a huge turnaround for art anyways, story-wise. Yeah, the last issue was pretty awesome. And, you know, dealing with Zod and the Eradicator and things like that, you know, it's kind of fun when you mix something from Superman's universe with Green Lantern's universe, and see how it works without having Superman in the equation. So, I think it's a fun story. And, you know, Zod, he's a crazy ruler, you know, he wants to rule everything. So it's interesting what he's going to do next. And especially with, I don't want to give spoilers, but there's going to be some internal conflict for a favorite character of ours since he, something crazy just happened to him recently. So,
Alex, what do you think?
I think it was the first issue that Garrett had talked about going that you weren't as big of a fan of Zod showing up. I loved the first issue, 38. I thought was great. I was so excited to see Green Lanterns go up against someone that isn't necessarily in their wheelhouse, so it gives them more of a, at least to me, a challenge. And 38 was excellent. There's some great panels. The writing was superb. I'm excited for this is a book that, again, feels like it'd be my top five DC because it was just so good. It'd been kind of lingering on a sour note. It hadn't been quite as good as I had hoped. And it's these last two issues have really picked it up for me.
Mera, Queen of Atlantis, number one. This is Dan Abnett, Lan Medina, and Nicola Scott on the cover. Great cover. Like the cover a lot. From the pages of Aquaman comes a brand new adventure story, Mera, in her own title for the first time ever. As the brutal Atlantean civil war rages, Mera must keep the peace between the surface world and Atlantis. As the newly anointed queen, in exile, but when Aquaman's brother Orm, aka Ocean Master, learns of his homeland's fate, he'll stop at nothing to return Atlantis as its king and savior. I want to bring this up because I actually did think this looks cool. The only thing is that there's so many books to get, especially this week. I don't know what it was with these last 2 weeks. They waited for everything for the last 2 weeks. Like everything that never comes out is coming out. I think I'm going to read this in trades. But I just wanted to bring it up in case anybody was looking for it. I think I'm going to read this because I'm also catching up on Aquaman and trades. So, Mera, Queen of Atlantis. There we go. Teen Titans number 17. This is, speaking of, he's back. Nope, excuse me, Ben Percy, Otto Schmidt, Dan Mora on the cover. All of Garrett's favorite people right in this issue. The following, part one, in the aftermath of Super Sons of Tomorrow, the Teen Titans are left without a place to call home. But Titan's work is never finished. When the series of strange murders crop up in San Francisco, it's up to the team to crack the case and prevent further bloodshed. Garrett, what do you think? Teen Titans, it's all your favorite people in this book.
What do you mean by that? I feel like you're joking with me.
No, I know. You like Ben Percy, right?
Yeah.
You like Otto Schmidt?
Ben Percy, Otto Schmidt.
Dan Moore?
Dan Moore is on the cover.
I'm not joking. That's all your favorite people.
Oh, I know. I don't know if you're being sarcastic or not. It's like everyone on this cover I like. But this is a powerhouse book. I think, holy crap, Otto Schmidt being on this book is going to change everything. Dan Mora's art, you can already see on that. Percy was killing it on Green Arrow, so I'm all in on this issue. I'm so excited. Even though I know the series is ending soon. Yeah. This is a great place to kind of jumpstart the last little bit of whatever's left of this series.
You know how many issues are left of this?
I don't, because it is ending in May.
It ends when Justice League, what's that arc called that he's doing, Scott? Justice
no
League?
No More.
No More, yeah.
Justice and that, League,
or No Justice.
Or no Justice.
Justice League.
That's probably May.
It starts in May, yeah, so it'll run to May. It's so only
probably two more
another one or two
three
issues.
Three more, okay. Including this.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I was apprehensive about whether or not I actually wanted to get it. It like that. But which issue had the Starfire? Was that last one? The 16?
Yeah, which I can't believe you didn't like. That was so good.
I really didn't care for it. Like, I read it and really? I was just maybe I was just in the wrong mood to read it, but I was bored the whole time.
Yeah, I forgot to message you on that because I read it and I was like, this is amazing. Like, Marv Wolfman gets that character 100%.
I didn't feel that way. I was like, this is kind of, I could have lived without it. So I'm just like, do I really care about this team anymore? So,
but Otto Schmidt on art, come on. That alone should be getting that book.
Yeah. We'll see. I'll look through and see if I like it.
The Terrifics number one. This is Jeff Lemire, Joe Prado, Ivan Rice. Garrett, a while a second ago, you said when you think of Green Lanterns, you think of Ethan Van Sciver. I think of even Ivan Rice. He did it way back in the day with Jeff Lemire. That's Jeff Lemire. Jeff Johns. This is, I'm not going to read too much of what it's about. Well, basically, here's a little bit snippet. I'll read this one sentence. When Mr. Terrific, Metamorpho, Plastic Man, and Fangirl find themselves literally bound together by a tragic accident, our team of unlikely heroes must rely on one another to make their way back home. Which basically is the story of Fantastic Four, and they haven't been too shy from saying this is basically Fantastic Four because Marvel won't do a Fantastic Four book. And there's a couple of things I like about this. I like the team. Everybody involved is very unique. I don't think we're going to get a book with four of the same people. I do like, if you look at the cover, Ivan Rice is credited at first. Once again, going to this line that they're saying artists are first, which I've noticed recently. And like, again, I'm not always going to slam Marvel, but when you keep doing stuff that I notice, they recently announced some books and they announced a writer and no artist, and which is like, how can you make a comic book and not have a team ready for that book? You just have a writer. It seems like you're just coming up with stuff and putting it out there. So I do like that this is going to be like Ivan Rice, Jeff Lemire, and if you've been following any of them on social media, you know they're working together as a team to get this book out, and it really is the team effort. So I do like that, artist first. And I just like that it looks $2.99. It's not $3.99. And it just sounds like a cool book. What do you think, Alex?
I think I'm excited for this book for the fact I don't really know any of these characters. I know Terrific's on Metal right now, but I had never heard of him prior. Metamorpho was in something else. I'm thinking of, was there a Lady Metamorpho?
Yeah, there was for a little bit.
Okay. I knew of her. I don't know about, like, I'm excited for this book that I don't know many of these characters. I'm just getting brought into a new world. My man Jeff Lemire is writing this book, so I'm super pumped. And Ivan Rice is doing the art, so this book is going to be spectacular.
There is one thing that I don't like about this. It's just that Metal so far behind that we haven't got to the point where Plastic Man's out of that egg, but it looks like in this he'll be out of it. So this is taking place after Metal. So hopefully it doesn't ruin anything. I mean, not that there's much to ruin probably. What do you think about that, Garrett?
Yeah, that is going to be kind of annoying, but I mean, probably going to get Metal 6 here. What is it, coming out in April or something? So
yeah, so it's going to be a little
I don't think it's coming out in March. But I don't want to bring you guys down. I know you didn't read the preview, but like I read that preview and it was very wordy. So I'm like, I know that's only a snippet of the whole book. So that, but I'm like, to get me interested in it, it didn't really do a great job, but I'm excited for the team of people on it, the team working on it. I think it has a lot of potential to be that Fantastic Four book that we're really looking for. I just hope that it's not getting drowned in too much text.
Oh, and this is, Jeff Lemire's return to a DC ongoing book, so he's back over here. So I did notice what you mentioned, Garrett, but I think the art is good enough that it does not gonna take away from the pacing. It'll be okay, is what I'm trying to say. I think the pacing.
Well, I think it'd be ironic.
But if I can't see the art is what I'm saying, then what's the point of putting them top billing?
I think it'd be DC's irony if they chose to make it super wordy, where you're going to miss out on the art, since that's the whole point of these, what, 6 or 8 books? I think they
I'm just judging it based off what I saw all the words that are
in, I know, but I'm saying, what if they? That's all the words that are going to be in that book. Is all the wording
that's good for me then?
Let me look at that preview real quick, but let's move on. IDW Publishing, TMNT ongoing, number 79. This is Tom Baltz, Kevin Eastman, Bram Revel. This is Invasion of the Triceratons, part 4 of 5. Alex, how's TMNT ongoing, man?
To be fair, it's been a long time since I've read it, but I am caught up on it. The turtles are actually in the book, so Garrett's pleased with that. I love the Triceratons, so I'm excited to see these not even mutate necessarily, Triceratops come down. They came in peace Agent Bishop was a dick. He attacked them. Now they're going to beat the shit out of everybody, and the Turtles have to stop them. Try to do a peaceful negotiation amongst everybody, which I'm sure won't turn out very well. So I'm excited to see where this book is going. But
I just read part two of the story, and it's been a huge turnaround. Like, you're right, the Turtles are in it. It makes sense how the Turtles interact with the Triceratons. It's not just like, oh, this story's going on and the Turtles are doing their own thing. And I think that Splinter's a fucking dick now. He sucks.
Well, the one thing with that, I understand Splinter's, so spoilers from almost 30 issues ago, Shredder's gone and Splinter is taken over as the head of the Foot Clan. He's kind of, he's a dick. And Mikey even left for a while.
He doesn't even feel like their father anymore.
No. And that's the thing that I think bugs me the most, is that one of my favorite character moments is when Splinter calls the Turtles his sons. And literally, they are his sons. They're reincarnated versions of his kids. And he just treats them like they're not worth his time anymore. So I'm hoping eventually Shredder's going to come back, I hope. Whether it's Rokusaki or Karai takes over, I want them to be a family group again, because it's unfortunate seeing Splinter be such a dill hole.
I was looking back at the Terrifics preview. By the way, actually, I did notice we're recording this late Tuesday night. There was already one exclusive review up, and I happened to look just to see if they liked it or not. I didn't really read what it said. I just wanted to see a thumbs up, thumbs down, and they said it was really great. And then there was a preview, there's a couple preview pages in there that actually weren't in the back of those books. It was actually a couple different pages. And I just want to say, Gary, I think maybe it's just the first couple pages you'll be wordy, and the rest is okay.
Okay, good.
Moving on, Image Comics. This is Beef number one. This is Richard Starkine and Tyler Shailene. This is Shaky Kane on art. The creators of Elephant Man and the creator of Amen join the forces of Tyler Shailene to bring a story of meat men. Chuck is a mild-mannered meat factory worker who is a little in love with a strawberry picker named Mary Lane. But everything changes when Mary Lane falls victim to the Valdino brothers. I have no clue what the hell this book's about. I just know there's a cover of beef on the cover in a can. And what kind of beef is that? That's that Spam. Looks like Spam.
Isn't that a spinoff of a... I think it's already going on.
I didn't say. No.
I think this is one of those books that if I had fewer books this week, I would actually give this number one a try just to see if I like it, because it sounds weird.
One of five. It sounds weird. So beef. Beef. Hey, where's the beef, Alex?
Oh. The Days of Hate.
Days of Hate number 2 of 12. This is Alex Cott and Angel. It says Yiling. I'm not sure. That's probably not your last name, but sorry. The plan is set in motion. That's all it says. And we got this great cover. I believe issue one we all did enjoy, even though a little bit was like, I'm not sure what's going on. But it was that nice confusion where it felt like I was confused. But eventually, I think we'll get there. But I remember there's moments in that book, and there was that two-page spread of that city that looked fantastic. So I think I'm still on board. What do you think, Alex?
I'm definitely on board. I trust Alex Cott to do something good with this book. Garrett and I read Generation Gone, and that book is great. I've read some of the New 52. Two issues were done by him, and those are two of my favorite issues in that series. So I'm willing to give this book the 12 issues to impress me. Because you're right, issue one was weird, but it was still pretty good. And these covers are immaculate. I love these covers.
Royal City number 10. This is Jeff Lemire and Jeff Lemire. This is the conclusion to the second arc. What's it called here? Sonic Youth. This is the story of Tommy. Right, Tommy?
Tommy.
Gary, what do you think? We're going to get this finale. We're going to see Tommy, how he passes away. We've been leading to this moment. What do you think about Royal City number 10?
It's been great. I freeze gonna really I know it's going to be a sad one. And so I'm excited for it, but like, you know me, and like knowing a book's depressing before going into it, that part I'm not looking forward to it as much, but like, I know that it's going to be a powerful story, that'll resonate with that first arc that we got. And so we'll be able to kind of better understand how the Pike family is dealing with Tommy's death.
Alex, what do you think? Royal City number 10, the conclusion of the second arc.
I think that this issue is going to be, I would assume, actually pretty heartfelt and a little hard to read. Being this book isn't a superhero related book, it's actually more of a real life take on a family's life. This is gonna touch home for, I think, many people. So I'm excited for this book. I'm kind of in that boat with Garrett. I'm kind of weary. And how sad am I going to be when I get done reading this?
I have a feeling it's going to be really depressing. And even looking at that cover already, I'm like feeling a little depressed. So we'll see. Saga number 49. This is Fiona Staples and Brian K. Vaughan. New story arc. We've been on a little break, right, Alex?
3 months.
The multi-Eisner award-winning series returns with a space-faring adventure about fake news and genuine terror. Get ready for the most shocking, most impactful chapters of Saga yet. I find that hard to believe, because the last arc was very shocking, very impacting. So if this is going to be more, I don't know if I can survive. Alex, what do you think?
This is one of those books that I'm so excited to read. But I'm hearing promises that I don't think can be cashed. Before we went on the last break, there were some amazing moments, some hard moments to read through, and some great imagery and great storytelling that I was blown away. So that I don't know if I can even be prepared for, if this is actually going to live up to what I'm told. Am I going to be able to live through that? Because I'm so excited to read this book and hearing this quote unquote promise. I don't even know if my brain can comprehend it. So,
do you think this week you'll re-roll City number 10 and Saga number 49 back to back?
I probably will, because I think I'll have to read the one to be depressed, and then Saga is going to have to reinitialize me and bring me back into the real world and be like, oh God, that was great. I'm not crying anymore.
Well, let's refresh with Marvel Comics, all new Wolverine number 31. This is Tom Taylor and Marco Feglia, David Lopez on the cover. Looks like we got a Deadpool. What do you think, Garrett?
So the last arc was great. This is the start of a new arc. Love that David Lopez is coming back and doing the cover art for this, because he was the one who did the first couple arcs that me and Alex read at the same time. So I hope that like this Deadpool will actually be like part of the book in a way that like matters it, rather than being so like Deadpool heavy that you're just like rolling your eyes the whole time. But Gabby, like Honey Badger, she's a funny character, and I think her interacting with Deadpool is going to be hilarious. So I'm excited for that, because you can tell that it's more like a team up book for Gabby and Deadpool, as opposed to Laura being involved in this book, even though she's on the cover. But you can tell it's going to be a lot more about Gabby. My only gripe is, costume, and they show her in the old costume like in a flashback in that same book. So when am I going to get that new costume? I'm sick of the black Wolverine costume. I want to see that yellow one that she has in X-Men and red. So whatever. Other than that, I'm excited for it.
All right. Dr. Strange number 386 and Donny Cates. Nico, Harichan. This is a Damnation tie-in. Dr. Strange in that poker match. Alex, you're still behind an issue, right? But I guess this is the tie-in. You probably could read this without reading the last one.
No, I caught up. I did. I caught up yesterday.
You look forward to Donny Cates' Dr. Strange.
I really like Donny Cates writing this book. I think a part of why I really enjoyed this book, though, is that Walt's art was top-notch. Who's doing this art for this book now?
Nico.
The same person as the cover artist.
Oh, really?
So if you look at that cover, that's the same artist that's on the inside. Yep.
Oh.
It's not bad. It's not, I mean, it's not Walta, but it's still pretty good.
That's pretty good, but I guess we're more in the fantastical realm right now anyway, where he's playing cards against Mephisto. So I'm excited for this issue. I'm excited to see where it's going. But I think I'm also going to be kind of sad to see that Walta's gone. But I think Donny Cates is doing a really good job on Marvel so far, so I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt to show me something I haven't seen before.
Yeah, we'll see. It looks like you guys said, the artist doesn't look half bad, so we'll see. Invincible Iron Man number 597. This is Brian Michael Bendis, one of his last books. Stefano Caselli, Alex Maleev, and Search for Tony Stark Part 5. Garrett, how's Invincible Iron Man been?
It's been so good. Having dropped off Infamous Iron Man and Invincible like prior to this, it was starting to dip off in quality. Now getting back on, because you get that Infamous Iron Man story and the Williams story, and getting a third story that's all about Tony Stark, Reed, and you can tell that Ben is planning something huge for issue 600. Which is his last issue for Marvel. So very excited to see what he's going to do 600. But
We'll
be a good issue too.
Garrett, do some more of that walking. Fight somewhere else. Jessica Jones, number 17. This is Brian.
Stop Michael doing side. What?
What do you mean? We can't. You're cutting out so much.
I've missed the last thing you just told us about Iron Man. Other than it was good.
Take a walk for a second. And Jessica Jones, number 17. This is Brian Michael Bendis. Michael. Gatos, David Mack on the cover. This is Return of Purple Man, Part 5. Garrett, you're the only one reading it, so let's see where we're at now. What do you think? This is the second to last issue, right? Penultimate of Brian Michael Bendis' run?
Yep. Issue 16 was great. I mean, Purple Man is... obviously Jessica's biggest villain, but everything like leading into this issue I think is going to be really powerful, and I think this will be the end of the arc, and then the next issue will be kind of like the swan song for Jessica Jones before Bendis leaves. So all I can say is the Purple Man, I mean, you thought he was fucked up before, now he's really fucked up, and at the end of last issue he asked Jessica a favor. Just gonna be kind of cool to see what happens in this issue. So I don't want to spoil anything, but definitely looking forward to it.
By the way, perfect. Settle in where you're at, because that's gonna be where you're gonna talk to us this show. And also,
that's
anybody,
where I'm staying.
You can save your fucking tweets and emails. I'm not editing any of this out of the show. We talked about it way too much. It would take way too much time. You can just have this to me and Alex laugh as we try to decipher what Garrett was trying to say. Legion number 2. It wasn't that much.
It's caught in the Matrix.
Yeah, it's out there somewhere. Somebody caught it. Mark Zuckerberg. He's just listening to it right now. Legion number 2.
Yeah.
This is Peter Milligan and Wilfredo Torres. Hey, Wilfredo's doing the art in this book? I didn't know that.
Nice.
Trauma part 2. How's Legion been? I know the show's coming back in a hot second here. Garrett, Legion number 2.
Issue 1 was fucking amazing. It was so good. I'm very excited for issue 2. Like Legion season 1 was, like the TV show, is the same kind of like mind fuck you get in issue 1, and I'm excited to see what happens in issue 2. Like, I've never been more excited about a series until I read that first issue, and it gets me to like right to where I know what David Haller is like, so I'm excited for issue 2 just as much.
I thought you got it, Marvin.
No, I didn't. Not Legion.
Oh.
I might have talked about it. I would flip through it, but I didn't get it. It's a 2 of 5, so it's a mini series. Maybe I'll read it when it's all collected.
Well, I know you'll eventually read it years down the line. I just thought that you liked the Legion character enough that you were getting it, so that's all I was asking.
Yeah, I do. He had a good mini series. I didn't even think it was mini originally. I think it was an ongoing, and then they canceled it. But it was pretty good before. I just wanted to bring up something: Marvel Avengers Infinity War Prelude 2 of 2. This is the finale of that. I mentioned when number 1 came out, I said, these usually don't mean anything. They usually tell us something we don't need to know. And I did read, spoilers if you're reading this, or if you're trying to catch, you're going to catch up with 1. It did tell us why at the end of Black Panther, in the after credits scenes, also spoilers for that, so give you a second, you can skip past this, why Winter Soldier Bucky is out of being frozen and why he's up and around now. So that's what that issue one was about. So if you only need issue two, you can. I mean, usually they'll mean much. Like, you don't need to know that to go watch Infinity War, but be cool if you want to see it. So Moon Knight 192, this is Max Bemis and Jack and Burroughs, Crazy Runs of the Family Part 5. Alex, I do know two things. I know you like this book, and I do know that cover is probably a great cover for you. How many is that, two of two?
That was two of two. I was going to tell you, that was the first thing I was going to tell you. Love this cover, love this book. Already probably I'm at least top two of my books this week. Favorite book of the week or pick of the week. I cannot get enough of this book. And when we talked about the last issue, you guys point out things that I'm just like, oh my God, I didn't even think about it. Makes me love this book more.
Yeah, I'm really
looking. No spoilers right there.
Yeah. No. Let's go back to our show. We think we're going to read the last few issues. We'll read this one, right? Is that correct?
Yes.
So we've been loving it, so we'll see where it goes from there. Star Wars, Star Fighter number 12. This is Charles Soule. What the heck? I usually can say his name. Giuseppe Camicoli.
Giuseppe Camicoli.
Garrett, what do you think? Darth Vader. Why is he holding his lightsaber so high?
What? I don't know. I mean, a lot of those covers don't really show you what's going on inside the book. It's like he doesn't even have his finished lightsaber done yet. He's been using somebody else's. So when they show those covers, I think that's just more for glamour. But inside the book has been great story. Amicoli's art is just so appealing to the eye and adventure books that don't mean anything. This story has been a lot of fun. And I think it's really getting into the internal conflict of Darth Vader / Anakin Skywalker. And it's like literally like right after he becomes Darth Vader. So very fun to see a fresh Darth Vader out in the universe.
Thanos number 16. This is Donnie Cates and Jeff Shaw. Thanos wins part 4. This is the secret origin of King Thanos' right-hand man, the comic Spirit of Vengeance ghostwriter, where you get an origin issue. And they just announced a new ongoing from Donnie Cates. This is one of them where they announced Donnie Cates is writing it, but they haven't an artist yet. Ghostwriter is coming out. Alex, what do you think? On that cover, we have Galactus with the huge gun. We have Ghostwriter as his right-hand man, but also, you know, in the future, he's with Thanos. Excited for this issue?
Oh, hell yeah. Donnie Cates was a golden gem. That doesn't even make sense. But I love this book. I am so excited to see where this issue specifically is taking us. The Cosmic Ghostwriter is what we were talking about earlier this week on our just text amongst us.
Yeah, yeah.
That will be coming out. Everything that Donnie Cates does from now on, I will be getting his books because this is one of my favorite series right now going on.
One thing in the other books from Boom Studios, we got Go-Go Power Rangers number 7. This is Ryan Perrette, Miguel Mercado with, that's the cover artist, Dan Moore on the cover and interior art. Two questions. Garrett, I know you enjoy this book a lot, but on that cover, look at that cover real quick. Those people dropping down, are those the new putties?
I don't know what they're going to be.
Oh, really?
I assume they're putties.
So how's Go-Go Power Rangers been?
Awesome.
You know what? I almost like Go-Go more than I like Mighty Morphin. Like, I love the Mighty Morphin book, but Go-Go, you kind of get that internal, like, you get to know more about the characters, their thoughts, like, how they're experiencing being a Power Ranger. So I think it's the more fun of the two books, where Mighty Morphin's all the action and the politics and things like that, and this is all leading up to the prelude of the Shattered Grid storyline, which is going to be a crossover between Go-Go and Mighty Morphin. So very excited for that event coming up here pretty quick. But this book itself, fun every issue. I've loved every single one. The quality has not dipped at all, and Dan Moore's art for a whole book, gotta love it.
You know, the one thing about the Go-Go Power Rangers putties is that they actually serve a purpose and are actually a danger to the Rangers. Because as of right now, There's someone who's been infiltrating the city to find out who the Power Rangers are, and they actually turn out to be a putty. And I am just, I'm floored that when they did in the TV show, it never seemed like, how could you not notice? This guy is scary, that he knows so much about a certain character, and just they actually are a good bad guy. They're a good foot soldier for the Rangers to go up against.
It's weird for someone to read his crew to be smart for once.
Those are all the books for February 28th, 2018, the last Wednesday in February. Garrett, what book are you looking forward to the most on that list?
Go-Go Power Rangers number 7, absolutely. I'm in the Power Rangers zone right now.
Go-Go Power Rangers. Alex, what book are you looking forward to the most this week?
This may actually be the hardest week for me to decide what I'm most looking forward to.
A lot of good ones.
I think in all honesty, I am looking forward to getting back into Saga 49.
Wow, with the that really surprised me. I thought there's two other books you would pick over that book, but yeah, Saga 49.
Both from Marvel?
Yeah, both from Marvel. But like you said, hard to pick, and I'm thinking about it. I think I'm going to go. Sometimes something brand new is more appealing than other stuff, but even though there's a lot of great stuff on this list, Terrifics number 1. I think I've been waiting for this since they first announced it. And a lot of good people on that team, a lot of good people on that creative team. So really looking forward to see how that starts off. So a lot of good books this week. Alex, if you would say, I've been looking at this weather forecast. A lot of warmth coming in. Is that because of all the good comics?
Of course. When you get good comics, you get that high pressure system, which brings in that heat. Of course. You're going to be reading these books. You know what? You're going to be drinking some lemonades. The sun's going to be out melting that snow. But be careful, put some salt down so it melts all that ice at night. Enjoy this week, because I have a feeling March is going to come in like a lamb, and it's going to leave like a bastard lion, so be ready for it.
What I do, Alex, is I do get some lemonade freshly squeezed, and I drink it while I read my comics, and I do use New 52 Superman number 1 as a coaster. Would you recommend that?
That's a wise choice. That's what I do, actually.
Fuck.
Garrett, how them roads looking?
You know what? It's another busy week. This is 3 weeks in a row. I think that the roads are a lot more manageable, so you don't have to go quite as early to get your books, but still a decent amount because there's a lot of high picks. Some of those things will sell out and will be off the shelf. So get there, get a nice copy. But yeah, there won't be any ice to swerve on tomorrow.
Garrett, looking ahead on the road, do you see any reprieve from the heavy weeks, or we still got a heavy week next week?
I look next week, and it's about normal next week. Finally, there will be a breath of more air than I'm used to.
So February less.
Like, what's normal? Because I'm hoping like
you know what normal is, Alex. It's anything not this, less like, than $15 shit that we're getting lately.
Less than $15, 15 books a week would be superb.
Hey, February less days, more books. That's the way it works. So
is that really how it works? Because I tell you what, February hurts.
It's still 4 Wednesdays. I was just kidding.
Well, we've had a lot of 5th week months lately, and. Not for February, though.
Obviously. Man, I say February hurt. So
hey, but all you can wish in this world, like this week, we're complaining a lot of books, but like Alex said before, a lot of good stuff coming out this week. So we're all complaining about getting a lot of good stuff, and that's where you got to be. That's the sweet spot. You got to get some Terrifics in. You got to get some Moon Knight in. Some Thanos. Some Go-Go Power Rangers. Some Saga 49. Royal City 10. All good. All good. Who's going to know this weekend that listens to the show on Sunday? See what we think of those books. For Wednesday Comics, I've been Marvin.
I'm Alex.
I'm Garrett.
Hey, everyone. Stay warm. Keep reading those books.